Hey there. Welcome to Module 6. Do you like the music? Okay, so this one is Jerome Price playing Eurasia. Get it? Ghost Eurasians? So, nice to see you again. We have made it. We're here at Module 6, and I might be getting a little loopy. I've been spending a lot of time sitting in my office recording videos, so hopefully my loopiness is like maybe making you laugh a little bit, even if it's laughing at me rather than with me. So what we're going to do for Module 6 is going to be a little bit different than what we have done for the earlier modules. The world of online teaching, the rule of thumb, apparently, is to not make videos longer than about 7 to 8 minutes. As you have seen, I have broken that rule just about every single video I have made. But see, my nephew, he's an undergraduate at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, and he told me that he really prefers longer videos because the little ones just chop everything up, and he says it gets really annoying. He said, look, college students, they know how to push pause. So I've, you know, kind of assumed that, you know, if I just do a variety of lengths, that it'll work. You guys, some of you will be happy, some of you won't be happy, and no one will be happy all the time, and no one will be unhappy all of the time. That's the goal. But this week, we are going to do it by the book, because the material can work really well that way. I can break up all of these little vignettes of past populations into isolated videos. And I think it might actually work even better than doing the way that I present the material in regular lecture format, because then I have to cram a whole lot in into 50 minutes, three 50-minute segments. So this one, we're going to break it out. There's going to be 13 different videos. And those will introduce you to these different populations. But what we're going to do in this very first one is introduce you to the general topic of the week and how things are going to unfold over the time. All right, let's get started. So where we left off at the end of last, basically the week, the module before last, was thinking about how a tree is not actually a good metaphor for the history of human populations. So if this is kind of like, wait a minute, I'm completely lost because I was so busy thinking about the great apes in the last module, maybe pause, go back and peruse module 4 and refresh your memory a little bit. Because it's really fundamental to get out of this thinking of human evolution, to think of evolution as trees, especially thinking about human variation, because the much better analogy that I have found over the years is to think about human populations more as coral, in the way that fire coral grows. So if you get closer up into the coral, like here, you can see that you've got human populations, so each of those branches is a human population, is that they diverge and they coalesce repeatedly through time. This is how I want you to be thinking about recent human evolution, because increasingly the genetic evidence is showing us this is the better model. You've already seen some of this evidence. So for example, we looked at these genetic admixture maps. This is from a paper that was published in 2017. And as I told you at the time, it's one of my favorite papers, because it really got me thinking about that imbrication, that very different pattern of human evolution. In this study, they had close to 6,000 individuals sampled from 282 different populations. They represent 30 different primary language families. And what they did in this analysis was, instead of telling the analytical method how many groups to go find in all of that genetic variation, they let the analysis run and find the number of populations that most comfortably accounts for the amount of variation observed in these genomes. And what that analysis came back with was that there are 21 different ancestry groups. 21 different ancestry groups. You can see them here in these admixture maps. So you have South Asia, and then Africa to the right, Europe, Caucasus, and the Middle East, and then Oceania, Asia, and the Americas. Each of those 21 different ancestry groups is indicated by a different color. And the most important thing to be taking away from this is noticing that hardly anyone of the individuals that makes up the small lines within these columns, hardly anyone is only one color. Hardly anyone is only one ancestry group represented in their genome. The vast majority, 97% of living people, have evidence of at least six of these ancestry groups in their genomes. I've put this this admixture map up on B-courses, so you know, definitely go check it out. I'll make sure that there's a link to it in the experience, this first experience for Module 6 for you, so you can look at it up close and really get a sense of that. So this is all living people. This was done on modern populations. What we're going to do in this module is add time depth. Over the last 4 years, there has been a dramatic revolution in genetic studies, in population genetics. This has been because of the addition of ancient genomes, ancient DNA, into the research. We talked about the earliest studies of ancient DNA in hominids, started in 1997 with the Neanderthals, and then we added some more ancient DNA onto that. Well, instead of looking at those deeper hominids in terms of time, we're going to be looking at ancient genomes in the much more recent past for this module. This figure gives you a sense of just how dramatically this research field has grown over the very recent past. So you just go back to 2014 and there were, you know, just a handful of papers, and by the time you get into the first half of 2019, you have over 1,000 papers that have been published just in that 6-month time period, and that rate, that pace has just kept up. It's tremendous. It's tremendous in good ways and bad ways. It's tremendous in great ways because there's a lot of research being done, a lot of scientific insight being generated. It's kind of bad in the sense that it's very difficult to get a handle on this literature. So I have tried to do this for you. So my recommendation for these modules is to stick with me and the way that I'm presenting the research here. A lot of the people who do this research, they have a new paper that comes out every 6 months or more, and there's not a lot of reflection back on the work that they have done in the past and kind of rectifying and putting it all together. That's because it's such a new research area. And when new research areas develop, it's just this explosion of discovery. And you know how we talked about science being hypothesis testing? Well, there's really two types of science. There's hypothesis testing science, but there's also hypothesis generating science. And when a field is brand new, it is just exploratory, looking at gathering as much data and looking for patterns and basically coming up with hypotheses that then get tested later. So ancient DNA research, this ancient DNA population genetics research, is very much in that exploratory phase of the science and hypothesis generating. And I think over probably the next 5 or 6 years, perhaps by 10 years from now, we will be in a hypothesis testing phase. But for right now, it is very exciting and can be very, very confusing. So hopefully I have been able to put it together for you in a way that will make sense. One of the things to keep in mind as we go through this is that there's a very strong geographic bias as to where this research has been done, where the skeletons from which DNA has been extracted are located, and that is in Eurasia. A lot of the research funding for this is coming out of the European Union. There is some in the United States, but the European Union is really leading the way in funding this research. And as a consequence, most of the research has been focused in Europe and expanded then out from there, but primarily across Eurasia. So this is the geographic region that we will be focusing on. This is not because I'm biased. This is not because, you know, I don't want to share this other research. This is just because this is where that science has been developed and where the access to the skeletons has been more readily available, because it is people studying their own their own history. Now, you know that Eurasians are really this very small clade of this small group of people nested within the genetic variation of humanity more generally, and that human genetic variation more generally is really a story about Africa, and that Europeans and Asians are just, and Eurasians are just this small little group within that. And so here's that structure that you saw earlier that we got initially out of the Con Wilson and Stone King work back in the 1980s, but that has continually been supported through significant amount of more recent research. So we have also considered this in that framework of Africa. So here is the genetic variation in African populations with that nice genetic admixture map at the bottom, and then finding those coalescence points within those populations there. And this is an analysis where the number of populations was determined by the people doing the research. And so they were looking specifically at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different populations and asking for their genetic admixture map to code by 6. So to keep that in mind. And then finding that all of that genetic variation coalesces back 300,000 years ago or older. And then just to remind you, we did place that European context, that European genetic variation within this same framework. So you have a sense of that Eurasian ancestry coalesces back, roughly speaking, around the same time, perhaps a little bit deeper in time, as the African genetic variation from this particular study that we had also looked at. Again, living people. Now, we also looked at this other study looking at mitochondrial DNA and Y DNA. And remember, I showed this to you and then I sent you off to go read a newspaper article about it and answer some questions about what was going on with these data sets. This is the study from 2018 where they found that there is this bottleneck. Now we'd seen that bottleneck before in the mitochondrial DNA, but seeing it again with the Y DNA, and also seeing that the pattern of genetic variation within mitochondrial DNA and Y DNA has a bit, it's quite different. And so why is that? I brought this study up again, one to remind you of that analysis, because it will come into play a little bit. I want you to be able to have this, you know, in your mind while you're listening to and learning about the populations across Eurasia that we'll be talking about in this module. But I also really wanted you to be thinking about what happened there in that 5,000 years ago time period, where there's this really restricted amount of genetic variation and then a vast expansion of genetic variation. So we don't actually have a really strong sense of what was going on with the genetic variation prior to that, because what happened is that these human population, very generally, went through this bottleneck. And you've talked about bottlenecks in your discussion section. You had the lab activity for this back in Module 5, and had a sense of how this works and how it restricts genetic variation. So we see that there was this really big, incredible bottleneck that happened in our lineage about 50,000 years ago. So keep that in mind, because now we're going to be looking at things happening on this side of that bottleneck. One of the things I wanted to introduce to you is a possible explanation, a hypothesis that has been put forward to explain why there was a bottleneck. So about 74,000 years ago, there was this giant volcano in Sumatra, shown here on this map. It erupted. It was a huge volcanic eruption, 2,800 cubic kilometers of ash. So there's, just like with hurricanes, there is this volcanic explosivity index. So you know how we have these different categories of hurricanes? We have different categories, different scale for volcanic eruptions too. And it goes up to 8. And this volcanic eruption at 74,000 years ago was 8 on a scale of 8. It's a volcano called Toba. And the super eruption has led to the Toba super volcano hypothesis. And the idea is that it was this dramatic volcanic winter that was caused by this super eruption that led to a decline in human populations. this massive volcano and the massive climatic change that happened on this global level as a consequence that created this dramatic reduction in human population and dramatic intense selection on humans, where you lost a lot of populations and a lot of genetic variation as a consequence. And that's why we have this evidence of a genetic bottleneck at that time period. It's a hypothesis. There's a lot of people still arguing about that. But we do know that there was an awful lot of climate change going on, regardless. Oh, I hate irregardless, and here I'm doing it. Regardless of the Toba super volcanic hypothesis, we have seen this before. This is that figure showing you the oscillation in temperature over the last 650,000 years, and we have the Toba volcanic eruption at about 74,000 years ago, and that happened as we were heading into a cold spell, into an ice age at the time. And then we were in that up until about 20,000, about 16,000 years ago, kind of depending on where you are in the world when you came out of that ice age. So this gets us thinking then, gets you primed to be thinking about these major themes in the population genetic history of Europe. One is climate change, and volcanoes have been critical factors in this. The genetic evidence corresponds fairly well, actually, with the archaeological record, and I will make those connections for you as we walk through all of this. We have found that there are two ancient populations that account for a significant amount of genetic variation in Europeans today, but we aren't entirely sure who those two ancient people were. The names that have been given to them are the Basal Eurasians and the ancient North Eurasians, and you'll meet both of them over the course of this module. We have also found that the nuclear genetic contribution from Neanderthals, it diminishes gradually over this time period. So if you go back about 100,000 years ago, there was more, we think that there was more Neanderthal nuclear DNA in the human populations living outside of Africa, so across Eurasia, than what we see today, and that gradually this has diminished over time. Okay, so now that we have set up Eurasia, let me get you back into some music. And with that, we're at the end.